welcome to the Dunkelgrün podcast. This is a podcast primarily about knitting, but also sometimes spinning, dyeing, and other textile crafts. My name's Anna. Today is Sunday, the 19th of November, and I'm coming to you from Zurich in Switzerland. If you want to join me on social media, you can find me on Instagram and on Ravelry as Dunkelgrün. We also have a Ravelry group for this podcast where you can join us for a lot of fun chatter, and this is the Dunkelgrün group. It has been a couple of weeks since my last episode, and so I have a lot of exciting new things to show you. And we are going to start right away with a giveaway. Recently, I have noticed, even though I was quite absent from YouTube the last couple of weeks, I have noticed that we have reached 3,000 subscribers on YouTube. Thank you so much to everybody. It is so incredible that there are so many people subscribing to my videos and enjoying the content. Thank you for all your messages, and you are making my days. I am really happy to have this community together with you. So, in order to celebrate, of course, it's time for a giveaway. So for this giveaway, I would like to give you a wonderful skein of yarn dyed by Alfinete in Portugal. This is a 100% merino yarn, and it's fingering weight, and it is hand dyed by Paula in Portugal. She is an incredibly creative dyer. She does not have any colorways. She just dyes all of her yarns in unique colorways that she comes up with, and this one is green, and so I thought it fits very well as a giveaway prize for the Dunkelgrün podcast. And together with this wonderful skein of merino from Portugal, I would like to give you a set of project bags from Slovakia. These project bags are by Lamy Projects from Slovakia, and they are the blue stuff that you can see here is dyed with indigo. So this is a traditional Slovak technique of block printing a resist and then dipping the fabric into indigo. I have talked about this a little bit before, and it's just wonderful. It's my lovely friend Martina from Slovakia who is making these together with her friend, and she has kindly donated me a couple of these bags for the podcast. So the first one is a very large bag with a drawstring to pull it together, and it has a lot of space for a big project. Also inside you have wonderful little pockets to put away your knitting needles or pattern or whatever, and together with this I'd like to give you this small little zipper pouch, which Martina said she would use this even to knit one little sock if you're like knitting the second sock and you don't want to carry around the whole bag. So for like a 50 gram ball of yarn, I think for me it would be a bit too small, but I'm sure if she's able to do it and there's other people who would also like to do it. And if not for a sock, you could use this wonderfully for notions and little things that you can then put into your larger project bag. So this wonderful little set is gonna be up for grabs, and I'm going to open a thread in our Ravelry group, and there will be a prompt there where you can enter for the giveaway. So my next big announcement, many of you know already, is that I have finally released my pattern for the unicorn, for Unini, the magic unicorn. And I am so happy that this step is finally taken, because it was so much work and it took me such a long time. And thank you to all of you who have encouraged me and who have followed along. It was a big help to hear your encouraging comments and words. So now Unini is available on Ravelry individually, and I have also prepared little yarn kits that I am selling through Etsy. So this is how they look like, and I put together just the amounts of yarn that you would need to knit the unicorn, and of course there is a code included in here for the pattern. And the first round of kits that I put on Etsy has just gone away like this. So I have made a second update. This happened on Friday, and there are still some kits available if you're interested. I hope that by the time this video goes up, there are still some available. Otherwise, contact me or wait a little bit, because as time permits, I will continue to prepare little kits. So I have been quite busy dyeing these colors in my free time during the last couple of weeks and putting together the kits. In order to celebrate the release of my unicorn, I would like to give away one of these kits to a viewer of my podcast. And this giveaway will happen via Instagram, so head on over to my Instagram feed and find the post with the giveaway to enter to win one of the unicorn kits. And with this, we are ready to head on to finished projects. Since it has been quite a while since my last episode, I have managed to finish some projects. Last episode, I have shown you a bobblehead in progress, and this hat has since been finished, but I don't have it with me because I already gifted it to my mother. I took a picture, I think I took a picture before I attached the pom-pom, so I will insert that here. And I also have a picture of all the three bobbleheads that I have knit in comparison. So here you can see my three bobbleheads that I have knitted. Only one of them is still with me, that's the one with the lightest blue and lightest green color. That's my own hat, and the darker ones are for my mom and for my brother, and they have already received them and they really enjoy wearing them, as far as I have heard. So the bobblehead is a pattern by Donna Smith, and I couldn't recommend it more. So I've knit it now three times, and it might not have been my last time knitting it, because also the combination of this thick Shetland yarn with the colorwork creates such a dense fabric that if you wear this hat outside in the cold, in the wind, it's so warm. There is just nothing. There's none of my hats that is as warm as this one, because even wind cannot pass through this fabric as easily as it can through other knitted fabrics. So if you make a bobblehead, I very much recommend you to get the Aran Weight Shetland Heather yarn, because it's just gorgeous. It's just meant to be, this hat. I'm thinking about making myself a garment out of this hat also. I don't have a sweater quantity of the yarn, but I could change that, because I think it would be just a really good all-weather garment that I could put on when it's really cold and when I need the extra warmth. And also it's a little bit water resistant, so if you go out and it rains just slightly, or there's a little bit of snowfall and you're wearing this hat, your hair won't get wet, and the hat really dries super fast once you're getting back inside. So it's the perfect winter hat. I don't think I'm gonna wear any other hat for this winter. My next finished project is... It's my sweater that I have been showing off on the podcast already quite a lot. So this pattern is the Fall Flowers by Vera Sennen, and the yarn is Malabrigo, Malabrigo Arroyo in the colorway Potion. And I have adjusted the pattern slightly to work with this board weight yarn, because the pattern is written for fingering, I think for fingering or for DK. No, I think for fingering weight yarn. And I have adjusted it for the gauge of the sport weight Arroyo yarn, which is, it's actually a sport weight, but it has a kind of the gauge of a DK. So it has as much yardage in a skein as a sport weight yarn, 300 meters, but it knits up to a more DK-ish gauge, which means you get a lot of material out of one skein. So I have used only 4 skeins of yarn for this whole sweater, and I even have some leftovers here, and I still have the gauge swatch also left over. So yeah, that is quite efficient, less than 4 skeins of yarn for quite a big sweater. Well, it has a bit good amount of positive ease. I am usually wearing a size small, but you can see it's a little bit bigger. I will put it on for you in a second. I just wanted to show you the ribbing. So the ribbing at the cuff and also at the neckline and at the bottom of the sweater is a special kind of ribbing. It's like a broken rib. It's like one row you knit and one row you knit one purl one. And that's how it looks, and I think it has a really cool effect. So in the pattern, the designer originally wants you to have the reverse side with the purl bumps on the outside. And I have changed that so that the side with the knit V's kind of is on the outside. And first I had knitted the neckline with the way that the designer intended, with this purl bump side on the outside, but then I had decided that this, I don't know, it rolled up somehow compared to the knit fabric, the stocking knit fabric of the main body. It did not really go so well. So I have ripped the neckline out, and I think I took a picture of it also. I might insert it here, where you can see the neckline how it was before. And also I had the problem that the neckline had too much fabric here in the center. So what I did, can you see this little triangle here? I worked some decreases here to consume a little bit of fabric, because I didn't want to have this floppy neckline. And also in the bind off, I did a normal bind off, and I did it very tightly, so I did not do it loose, because the neckline is already quite wide and I didn't want to have it flare even more. And the buttons, you can, I think when I go a little bit away from the light, it shows a little bit better. I have posted on Instagram about these buttons, and I went with this choice now because I really liked the red button, because it picks up some of the red flecks in the yarn, and also the yellow and green. I really like them. Here on the sides, we do have a reverse stockinette panel. And can you see this? At the bottom here, I have attached this little leather label of my logo. And I'll include a link in the show notes of the shop, the Etsy shop where I got this logo from. It's the Leather Goods Company. And not this logo, the logo, I made the logo myself, but I ordered the label from the Leather Goods Company, and I'm very satisfied with it. I think it looks really cool here at the side of the sweater. So here it is. It fits really well. You can see the reverse stockinette panel under the arms. It has a little bit of a triangular shape because there are some increases, some A-line increases worked into here. The neckline is pretty wide, which I think is nice, but it still holds up. It's still nice and crisp, and yeah, I am very, very satisfied with it. The construction of this sweater was top-down and seamless, but it still looks like a satin sleeve, so there is a special little bit of short row shaping and picking up stitches here at the top to make it look like a satin sleeve. And I think the sleeves, they fit just very, very well. I am very satisfied with how it turned out, and I really love the color. I have already worn it out a couple of times, and it's just so nice because it looks, from far away, it looks like a pretty neutral color. But when you go close up, you can see all these fun colors in here. And here you can see again the cool kind of rib that this pattern includes. Of course, I have changed the rib a little bit because I just inverted the side that is inside and that is outside, but I really like it. So another sweater in my wardrobe, yoohoo! Now I have to take it off because my living room is kind of warm. We have a heating in the ceiling here in this apartment. So this is a rental apartment. And there is heating in the ceiling, which is weird. I think it was a trend in the 50s or so, or maybe not even a trend, but our building where we're living is quite old, and so we still have this heating in the ceilings. And I have to say, even if we turn it down to very low, our apartment is always very warm. So I have to remove my woolly sweater, unfortunately. So these are all my finished projects for this episode, and we are ready to move on to works in progress. The first work in progress I want to show you is not extremely exciting. It is a little tube of 2x2 rib in a grayish color. And this is not gonna be a mitten, not gonna be a sleeve. It is gonna be a balaclava for my boyfriend. And he has requested this because my boyfriend is from Brazil and he just moved to Switzerland 2 years ago, and so he's still not quite used to the cold winters that we have, and he will really need this once it gets even colder. It's already pretty cold outside now, but I think he will need this. So it's gonna be a tube up to here, then it's gonna have an opening, and then on the top it finishes with some decreases just like a hat. And there are two free patterns on Ravelry. One is the Easy Balaclava. I forgot the designer's name. I will put it in the description here. The Easy Balaclava, and the other one is Drafts Balaclava. And I'm kind of incorporating some elements from both. So I do the 2x2 rib. I use worsted weight yarn. It is Malabrigo Rios in the colorway Tormenta. This is how it looks. It's a very varied gray, very interesting gray with a little bit of blue in it. And Tormenta means storm, so that is quite fitting, I guess. And yeah, I think it's quite interesting how it pools a little bit. You can see that the colors are flashing a little bit, but I think that it fits for this kind of project. And this is a very quick knit. I have only knit a little bit, time-wise only a little bit on it, and I'm already quite far, so I think soon it's time for the face opening. Yeah, that's it for this project. My next work in progress is one that makes me very, very happy. It lives in my wonderful indigo dyed Lamy project bag from Slovakia. It is my exploration station, and this is a pattern by Stephen West, and everybody knows it. I don't think I have to say a lot about it. I had it in my Ravelry library already since it came out, I think in 2014, and I never knew which yarns to use for it. And this year I have been doing a lot of natural dyeing, and I realized how well natural dyes always go with each other. They just always fit together and they just always look good together. And so I realized this pattern should be done in 4 naturally dyed colors, and that's what I did. So the yellow is onion skin, the blue is indigo, and the two browns that you can see, there is a lighter brown, a caramelly brown, and a dark coffee brown, and these are both walnuts. Walnut husks and leaves, I use both. Actually, I started with leaves and I didn't really like the shade, and then I over-dyed it with the husks. So here you can see that I have already finished the brioche section that is very famous. I have knit brioche before, so this was not such a big crazy thing for me to knit this brioche section. Here we have the slip stitch section, and now I have just knit this little bit of the last section before there is gonna be the edging, which is gonna be again in the dark brown. And I just really love knitting these West Knit shortcut rows, which are the ones that we are starting with here, the first section. This is just so much fun. I have knitted the Dolly Dress this summer, and it was just I just love this way of knitting. It's just so cool because you're never knitting the whole row, you're just turning before it finishes. And yeah, the outer parts here, I think they're not as exciting as the shortcut rows, especially because the rows are getting really long. I'm not such a big fan of doing brioche over very long rows, over so many stitches, but it was fine and it was interesting to see how the two colors are playing together. I think it's just really nice. Yeah, I am looking forward to having this shawl done on the one hand, and on the other hand, I also really enjoy the knit and I don't want the knit to be over, but yeah, you can see it's gonna be big because this is not yet blocked. And I have, to be able to show you this, I have actually connected two of my cables. That's why I can stretch it out that much on the cable, because I have here this cool cable connector. These are knitpicks. Knitpicks? No, not knitpicks. We don't even have any knitpicks here. These are the Knit Pro needles, and they are 3.5 millimeter, or no, they are the 4 millimeter Knit Pro Symphony needles, and I really like the Knit Pro needles because the stitches just slide very well, and I like the smooth surface of these wooden needles. They are just one of my favorite kinds of needles. And you can connect the cables to create a super long cable so that it is easier to see your knitting or your shawl if it gets very large. So that is The Exploration Station by Stephen West out of my naturally dyed yarn. The yarn is a single merino superwash yarn, and maybe I have something to say about that. I have never knit with a single superwash single before. This is a very popular yarn and a very common yarn. It's like same kind like Adeline Tosh Merino Light, I think it's called, and you can see that in a lot of projects, or all the Hedgehog Skinny singles. A lot of people use these yarns. I have the feeling that with a single yarn you can feel the nature of the fiber much better than when the yarn was plied, because you don't have, I don't know why that is, but I have the feeling that it is like this. And so you can also feel the superwash a lot better, I think. So the whole feeling is very soft, but I can feel this superwash feeling, especially after I have knit many bubble hats with rustic woolly yarn. I don't know if I'm still a huge fan of knitting with superwash. I have some more singles yarn in my stash, but I don't know if I would knit a lot more with that. Let's see, depends on the project. I think for this project I wanted to use this kind of yarn because that's how the original shawl was knit, and I thought I want to match that somehow. But yeah, I think the feeling, even though it's soft, don't get me wrong, it's extremely soft, but you can feel this superwash feeling, this little plasticky, unnatural feeling. You know, it's not like, it doesn't feel like wool anymore. You lost the feeling of wool. It feels like a synthetic fiber, a little bit. Not as much as acrylic, but I think many of you will know what I mean. But nevertheless, I love my Exploration Station. My last work in progress is one that you have seen before. It's a pair of neon socks, which I am knitting for the boyfriend of my sister. And I dyed this yarn using the solid dye powder speckling technique, and I think it looks really cool. It's just glowing and it looks really radioactive. So I'm knitting this on my new Jiaogu needles. I think it's the Jiaogu lace, and it's 2.5 millimeter size, which is my standard sock needle size. I think that's US 1.5. And yeah, this cable is just fantastic. I know that everybody likes using that for socks, but I think it's gorgeous. It's just really cool. And I'm knitting them toe up and two at a time. I'm using the same kind of construction as Verena Kors does in her etc. socks, but I am not doing the pattern, I'm just doing a plain vanilla. And I started knitting this by using the ball of yarn from one thread from the outside and one from the inside, and this made me crazy. So I had to divide the yarn up into two balls, because so if you're pulling the yarn from the inside and from the outside, you just always create this tangle that you have to unwind, and you already have to take care the way you turn if you're using two balls, because you don't want the yarns to tangle. But I have a feeling if I knit from the same ball from the inside and the outside, I don't know how to manage that. So I wanted to talk about something related to this color today, because you can see it is neon, it is glowing, and it looks just different to a normal green like this here, or my background. It just looks like it's glowing. And I wanted to talk to you about the science behind that and why this looks like it's glowing and why you cannot find this color on the color wheel and why you cannot mix it from your primary dye colors. So in order to explain you why such a neon color, why a neon color is looks like it is glowing, I need to explain you the very basics of how color is produced, or how, why we see colored objects. So you maybe remember from basic physics that white light is actually not white, it consists of a whole rainbow of colors. So if you shine a white light on a prism, it will diffract the white light and produce a beautiful rainbow of all colors. And on the other hand, if you put all the rainbow colors together, they're producing a white light. However, if you now take this whole rainbow of white light and remove one or several colors of the rainbow, you're not anymore left with white light. So what you get is colored light, because you kind of remove something from the mix. And it works like complementary colors. So if you remove blue, you are going to see orange. And if you remove orange from the rainbow, you're going to see blue. And what actually happens with a green colored object like this one, or like grass or trees, is they are taking out the complementary color to green, which would be red, out of the spectrum of the light. So the white light hits, and this here absorbs the red light, and that's why it looks green. And what happens inside the color molecules inside this yarn or object is that there are electrons inside the molecules, and once they absorb the light, they are excited to a higher level. And for a normal color, this does not matter at all. It just absorbs the light and the electrons are excited, and at some point the electrons are going to go back to the way they were before, and you don't notice anything else. However, with a neon yarn, the light hits the object, the electrons get excited to a higher level, but these molecules are special. So the energy that is stored in these excited electrons is going to be released by emission of light. So what actually happens is it absorbs light, in this case UV light with a high energy, and afterwards emit light with a little lower energy. And this is the color that you can see glowing, because this object does not just absorb light to have a color, it also emits light. And the normal primary colors that you are going to find on in your acid dye set or any other in your pencils, they don't have molecules in them that emit light. And this emission is what we call luminescence, or in this case, fluorescence. Normally, your primary colors, they do not do that. They just absorb light, and that's the way they produce color. And so that is special in the way that neon works. And that's also why if you want to dye neon yarn, you need to buy special acid dyes that are neon, because you will never be able to mix this color from your primaries or from the other colors that you already have. And also, by the way, glow in the dark is a similar principle, where you also absorb light and excite electrons to a higher level. And then the process of relaxing the electrons to a lower level and emission of light takes a lot longer. So in this one here, it happens kind of immediately. So if I turn off the light, you're not gonna see anything glow anymore. And in a phosphorescent or glow in the dark color, it happens slowly, and you are going to see the emission of light for a longer period of time. I hope that was not too confusing and too complicated, and you found it interesting. And yeah, that was my little story about neon colored yarn. And with this, we can move along to the next chapter. And believe it or not, this week I have some spinning for you. As some of you know, I have a new shelf to store my stash in my office, and it has transparent windows. And so I'm sitting there and I can see my stash pretty well. And I do have a lot of fiber stash, which I acquired about 3 to 4 years ago when I had a huge spinning phase. When I started to spin, I was really excited about it and I was spinning everything. So everything I would knit at this time was out of my own hand spun, literally. I didn't buy any yarn. I just spun my own yarn all the time. And at some point, I don't know why, it got a bit less. I think I had a point where my hand hurt a bit from spinning and I had to take a break. And so I started to buy more yarn or dye yarn that was already spun, it was not my hand spun. And so my spinning fiber stash was hardly ever touched. I showed some spinning projects here on the podcast rarely. In the beginning of the year, I started a sock spinning project, and there I have used some superwash fiber. Where we are again at the topic of superwash, I didn't enjoy spinning the superwash fiber. I don't mind knitting with something like Malabrigo, which is also superwash, because there I cannot feel it so well. But when you are working with the fiber, it just has this weird crinkly feeling on my fingers. And I think I just didn't spin on because I didn't enjoy that project. I don't know. Anyways, this week I was looking at the fiber stash and I was looking at this. And I was thinking, this needs to go on my wheel. This is a naturally brown colored BFL roving, non-superwash, from England. And yeah, it has been in my stash since ages, so I don't even know anymore where I got it from, but I know that it's British BFL. And yeah, I was looking at it, and I do have a sweater's quantity of this. I have, I think, almost 500 grams of it. And so I was looking at it and kind of, you know, when you start dreaming what you could do with a certain fiber or yarn. And I have also had a lot of dreams about yoked sweaters. A lot of dreams. I have never knit a yoked sweater before. I have knit a yoked dress, but it was a lace yoke. But I've never knit colorwork yoke. So these days on Instagram, you see a lot of things by different people that knit colorwork yokes, and so I would like to do something like that. And I'm thinking about the Talia sweater by Jennifer Steingass, which I think is just a stunning design. I love this design so much. It's so beautiful, and no matter which colors people choose, it's always beautiful. It's just amazing. So I'm thinking about using this as the main color for this sweater, and then spinning also some smaller quantities, maybe dyeing them before or after spinning, and yeah, create this colorwork yoke. And I have already started to spin yesterday. I started to spin yesterday and I really, really, really enjoyed it. It was a pleasure. So you can see I have already spun quite a bit, and my goal is to make a worsted weight yarn to ply out of this. This is my funny bobbin, which I painted. My spinning wheel, for those of you who don't know, I think I talked about it very long time ago. You can see it here behind me. It is an Ashford traditional from the early 80s. I received it for free from a friend who works at a school, and they wanted to throw it away. So he contacted me and asked me if I wanted it. He said, we have some old spinning wheel, and then he sent me a picture and I was like, what? This is an Ashford traditional. Of course I want it. And Ashford is really great. If you get an old spinning wheel that doesn't work anymore, you still get all the components to fix it and to tune it to work again. And I bought a new flyer for it, I sanded it, painted it, waxed it, yeah, got new bobbins. I got the sliding hook flyer, so these are the sliding hook flyer bobbins by Ashford, and I painted them also. So yeah, this is my spinning wheel, and I love my spinning wheel so much, and it's not getting enough love. And now I am very happy to have this project. It's probably gonna be quite a long-term project. I'm thinking about being able to wear this sweater next winter, because I have to spin a lot of fiber first. Let's see if I can keep the pace that I have started with yesterday. It might go a bit faster, but I have also other projects to work on, so who knows. So that's my spinning project. I am very happy to be back to spinning and to have a project that I actually really enjoy. Even though it's no colors, it's just natural wool, but I think that's exactly what I need right now. This feeling of wool that is not super wash treaty, that is just amazing. Wool is just amazing. I mean, we all know it, that's why we knit, right? Wool is the best material ever. And the other thing that is the best thing ever about knitting, apart from wool, is knitting friends. So I have received a wonderful package from a lovely knitting friend, and she is a member of our Ravelry group and posting a lot of things about the things that she's doing. She's a prolific spinner, dyer, knitter, and she's a super creative person. And her name is Fanny from Germany. Fanny has sent me a skein of yarn just as a thank you for my podcast, because she enjoys the podcast. And this skein arrived in the evening when I came home from work. I saw it in my mailbox and I opened it, and it just made me so happy. It was just such a happy moment to receive something dyed by another lovely fiber person. And it is dyed with walnuts, walnut husks. And it is a sock yarn, 75% wool and 25% polyamide. And yeah, I will just knit myself some socks out of this. I'm thinking about combining it with some red and dark green. Can you hear this? That's Lila. Come, Lila, come. I'm thinking about combining it with some red and dark green yarn and knitting myself some Christmas socks, because this color kind of reminds me of gingerbread. It's definitely a bit Christmassy, isn't it? With her package, Fanny also sent me a lovely little card and something extremely cute. This little felted pouch or baggie. Look at how cute it is. And inside, there are just some little goodies. A candle, a little soap, some tea. It's just incredibly, incredibly cute and heartwarming to receive such a gift from a knitting friend. So thank you very much, Fanny, and also a big hug to everyone else out there. You are all amazing, and I love to read your stories on Instagram. There are so many moments where I think that the knitting community is just the best. So with this, I would like to close this episode. Come on over to our Ravelry group, join us for our cal. I forgot to talk about the cal. We have a cal where we dye our own yarns and make our own projects out of our hand-dyed yarns. So if you have always wanted to try dyeing, come on over on Ravelry, join us. We're going to support you and we're going to follow you along with your dyeing journey. So with this, I would like to wish you a wonderful couple of weeks until I see you again. And as always, happy knitting! Bye!